Let's let our friends over there know who we are. And that we are the people.
Are negotiated in secret. You can't get into those meetings. I can't get into those meetings. They're behind closed doors. Once the unions and the governor reach a deal, they hand that deal off to the legislature. But the problem is the legislature has no say over the terms of the contract. They can't modify the contract. They can't modify the funding. They only get a yes or a no vote. And they've never voted no.
They're not going to gut collective bargaining in this state on my watch. Together we're gonna win this fight. Let's take the bastards down.
When I was walking up here, it reminded me of the movie Braveheart. A small group of Irishmen and a large British army. It reminded me of one particular scene. William Wallace was about to head over to the British and one of the Irish guys grabs and says, "Where are you going?" He says, "I'm going to pick a fight." Wow, yeah, I think this is a fight worth picking. I really do.
Hey! Teacher, leave the kids alone. All in all, you're just another brick in the wall. All in all, you're just another brick in the wall.
Yeah, the American Republic was safe until the Congress learned to bribe the public with the public's own money.
You know, if you want to get rid of the union dominance over Olympia, get rid of the automatic collection of dues through the state payroll system. We should also give workers a choice about union representation. No one should be forced to pay union dues as a condition of employment.
As we look around at the continued increase size and spending of the public sector, and the increased benefits and wages of public sector employees, and the increased influence of politicians who benefit directly.
Hey, there's Steve Conway here. Whose streets are these? Whose capital is this?
The government operations wouldn't happen without the taxpayer. You are the linchpin that holds all this together, and you're constantly despised and forgotten. They clearly don't appreciate you behind me. Yeah, you guys are the ones that make what they're doing right now happen.
Go home!
In the last 10 years, the rate of state spending in Washington State has grown over 1.5 times faster than the rate of population plus inflation growth. Over 1.5 times faster. Not once in the last 10 years during that increase in reckless spending did the folks who run this place actually fully fund their pensions.
Teabaggers, go home!
Lesson number one is Reagan's clear view that the foundation of what's right in America is limited government, and a government lives within its means.
Olympia does have a problem. It's not a revenue problem, it's a spending problem.
We're going to introduce ourselves, and then we're going to go back to work for you.
Once Washington's elected officials patch up the current budget, they have to deal with a $5 billion-ish budget deficit in the next budget. Our state has continued to increase spending, has continued to extend lavish benefits to state employees.
They're not going to gut collective bargaining on my watch.
And is now facing a much larger structural budget deficit over the long run to the tune of $40 billion. $40 billion.
On my watch.
Maybe there are two Americas after all. One America has been hit with pay cuts and big reductions in benefits. The other goes on strike when asked to contribute just a little bit to their health insurance.
Their union bosses might not, but they're portable, they give state employees more control over their dollars, and it saves all of us money. So advocate for health savings accounts. Number two, I got you. You got to advocate for moving the state from defined benefit pensions to defined contribution pensions.
Whose streets are these? Whose capital is this? What's our message to the teabaggers? Go home! Go home!
Reagan always approached every situation with a sense of optimism. He knew America could be that city on a hill because Americans can do anything if they work together.
Go home!
If we work together, stand on our principles, and peel a few of those folks off for what's right to the state of Washington, I think we're going to do really well. So as I leave today, you know, I'd urge you to let them shout and let us stand on facts, okay?
They're even keeping the teabaggers safe. These are the House Democrats. We're here fighting for you. We're going to introduce ourselves, and then we're going to go back to work for you.
Let them sulk, and we'll be the ones that will solve. And eventually, those folks will be ones that will lose, and you and I will be the ones that lead.
The stranglehold the public employee unions have on taxpayers. At their disposal are millions, literally millions of dollars in forced dues.
Get rid of the automatic collection of dues through the state payroll system.
Forced dues that unions spend to elect leaders who will protect their power and fund salaries and benefits that we can no longer afford.
And we're going to go back to work for you.
You got to advocate for moving the state from defined benefit pensions to defined contribution pensions. You need to advocate for a constitutional amendment that limits state spending to population plus inflation growth. We've sponsored a bill on that. This entire edifice is oriented towards growing government. The only way it can be restrained is if we have a constitutional amendment, because the folks around here just have a hard time not spending money.
Can you name a single state or municipality that has heavy union involvement that's thriving? No. How many of you want to be the next Detroit? Yay! Let's be Detroit, really? Or how about California or New York? Can you name a single municipality or state with heavy union involvement that is thriving? And the answer is no. These guys are the polar opposite of King Midas. Everything King Midas turned touched to gold. Everything they touch turns to crap. Right? And I want their hands off of my state and my children's future. Their idea, this is what their idea is. The people who brought you the Pinto, failed K-12 schools and bankrupt states, they want to be in charge of your economic future. Who thinks that's a good idea?
I'm Oscar Walker too. We always get a visit. Governor Walker's asking public employees to pay 5.8% of their salary toward pensions.
Have you ever seen Boeing management executives walk out and refuse to do their job until they're allowed to give in to more union demands?
Showing your support.
Because we're just talking to ourselves.
This walkout stuff illustrates the absurdity of public sector unions, because there's not two sides.
Democrats walking out, it shows who they're really representing. It's not the taxpayers, it's a special interest group. The fundamental conflict of interest at stake here, it's more than about the current financial crisis. It's about systemic conflict of interest that will plague this country and continue to leave us on unsustainable fiscal paths.
Let me tell you something about the people who walked away. They are far more opinionated than they are educated. And their fiery passion is only matched by the immeasurable breadth of their ignorance. And we should take them seriously, folks, because passionately ignorant people is where bad public policy comes from. Folks, we can't do anything about their passion, but maybe, just maybe, we can do something about their ignorance and their faith-based economics. I'm a professor of political science, so I deal in facts and data and research. There are 22 right-to-work states, and there are 28 union shop states. In the 22 right-to-work states, in the last 10 years, real personal income has gone up 28%. In the union states, 14%. And these guys, these generational parasites, they wave their save the middle class. We're saving the middle class. You want to look at job growth? In the 22 right-to-work states, they added 1.5 million new private sector jobs. In the union shop states, they lost 1.8 million jobs. That's a difference of 3.3 million jobs between a union shop state and the right to work state. We're building the middle class. They're undermining the middle class. Of the 10 states with the lowest unemployment in America right now, 8 of them are right to work states. A lot of my friends in Michigan and Wisconsin, they said, we lost a lot of jobs. I said, no, you haven't lost any jobs. I know exactly where your jobs are. They're in South Carolina. They're in Nebraska. They're in Kansas. They're in other right-to-work states. As long as we live in a world where labor and capital is mobile, Boeing doesn't need to go to China when it can go to South Carolina. GM doesn't need to go to Mexico when it can go to Louisiana.
You know, I was a teacher for 11 years in a right-to-work state, the great state of Texas. It's disheartening and appalling to me to watch teachers in the state of Wisconsin shut down whole school systems and be bullies to the taxpayers. And I think, what kind of lesson is that teaching our youth? They're not protesting against Scott Walker. They're protesting against you and I. We are their lifeblood to all those things that they claim that they want and they have the right to. Well, I don't believe that my husband and I should have to work an extra 10 or 15 years to save for our retirement so that we can provide them theirs free of charge. Being asked to pay 5.8% towards their pension, being asked to pay 12% towards their health care costs, I don't think that's unreasonable. And I hear things like that and I ask myself, who are the greedy ones?
Teabaggers! Go home!
These bully tactics that they're doing are setting a terrible example for our youth, are holding the taxpayer hostage, and I'm thankful that we have governors like Scott Walker who are willing to lead, who are willing to make the tough choices and look out for the best interest of the state, all residents of the state, not just the public sector union members. And I stand with Scott Walker because I stand for freedom.